My talk today is about the rise of analytics in marketing decision making. When I started my career in marketing research, the concern originally by Lord Leverhulme, the founder of the Unilever Corporation, about how half of his advertising spend was wasted, the problem being he did not know which half, was relatively widely spread among marketers. The inefficiencies in marketing that were yet irretraceable for managers naturally made any corrective action very difficult to take. This line of thinking was paired with marketing perceived as sort of a black box. It was well understood that investments in marketing were necessary for firms to reach their customers. However, the mechanisms through which investments in marketing were translated into customer and business outcomes remained somewhat a mystery. To open this proverbial black box, the attention of marketers was first focused on financials and short-term cash flow impact of marketing. Measures such as marketing return on investment were introduced to trace the input-output ratios related to marketing investments. As these measures of financial performance spread among marketing, marketers, however, soon realized this type of measures were relatively poor at capturing the value of marketing, as not all marketing investments are even aimed at producing short-term returns in financial terms, but rather aim at building brands or customer relationships that serve as so-called market-based assets that are yet to be materialized in cash flows only in the longer run. Therefore, this type of financial measures targeting sales revenues or short-term profitability were complemented by attitudinal measures targeting the intermediate outcomes of marketing activities. Net Promoter Score, nowadays a popular measure of customer satisfaction, serves as an example of such a measure targeting customer attitudes. Net Promoter Score looks at the ratio between customers who qualify as promoters versus those representing retractors, looking at the overall satisfaction of customers with the firm and its offerings. Later on, these individual measures of performance, be they related to financials or non-financial outcomes, were further extended to broader measurement systems, incorporating different types of metrics, addressing customers, their mindsets and behavior, competitors, and the firm's relative performance in the marketplace, as well as both short and long-term financials. These broader sets of key performance indicators that then formed diverse systems for marketing performance measurement also allowed firms to tailor their measurement systems better to the needs of individual firm in question. After all, we all understand that the exact mechanisms through which marketing activities translate into performance outcomes vary across firms and business contexts. Simultaneously, broader measures of market-based assets, for instance, customer lifetime value or brand equity, were launched to assess the overall health of the firm's marketing and these long-term assets generated by it. Taken together, these developments in measurement systems gradually replaced the black box with new transparency, allowing stakeholders, both external and internal to the firm, to better address marketing performance. Along with the development of marketing performance measurement, also wider uses of marketing analytics in marketing decision making were developed. And this development took place particularly in two main respects, as related to the content of analytics utilized in marketing, and as related to the development of related methods. To start from the evolution of content, first, the focus that was initially placed on financial returns of marketing was extended to the broader view, incorporating several types of measures of marketing performance. And the focus of firms was shifted from individual measures to also looking at the interrelationships between different types of outcomes for marketing, as well as potential trade-offs between them. This was best showcased in the adoption of so-called marketing dashboards in many companies that aimed at providing a holistic perspective to the firm's marketing performance with a single view. The idea of managing marketing with the use of such dashboards can be seen as somewhat analogous to driving a car, where performance could be improved by correcting the course there, or speeding up or slowing down there, which naturally makes most sense in contexts where the road ahead is more or less similar to the one behind, especially when based on these largely backward-looking performance measures. However, as we all understand, this is very seldomly the case in business or marketing, which is why the attention was soon shifted from mere performance measures to also more forward-looking uses of analytics in supporting marketing decisions. Models utilizing market data for earlier stage marketing decisions, such as segmentation or targeting, were introduced. The first such models largely focused on structured numerical data accumulated in firms, such as the vast amounts of purchase data in retailers or consumer goods companies. More recently, however, the focus in analytics has further extended to also look at the opportunities related to unstructured data, such as texts, images, or videos, which stands to reason as, according to some recent estimates, up to 80% of the data generated by consumers is unstructured in nature, naturally providing vast future opportunities for marketers. Along with the broadening of the scope of use of marketing analytics, another key development related to content relates to the goals set to a firm's marketing. Initially, the focus was placed on the traditional shareholder value and the financial impact of marketing activities. However, as the conception of firm performance has altered to not only focus on shareholders, but also the so-called triple bottom line and three key stakeholders, people, planet, and profits. This has also led to incorporating the new perspectives of environmental sustainability and social responsibility to the goals of marketing. This has put novel pressure on firms to also showcase their performance in terms of these newly set goals, which is likely to show in the evolution of marketing performance assessment and the related systems and metrics in the future. In parallel with the development of content of analytics, also the available methods have developed remarkably. In terms of this evolution of analytical methods in marketing, the development has been two-parted. with the traditional dichotomy between qualitative and quantitative approaches widening, perhaps further than ever. On the one hand side, marketing has become more quantitative than ever, with big data and more sophisticated methods and models. We have all diagnostic, prescriptive, descriptive models for supporting our marketing decision making that often require quite high sophistication in analytical terms, resulting in an urgent need for numbers-heavy marketers who are able to analyze the data and to translate it into marketing decisions. On the other hand, the new opportunities provided by unstructured data for generating more in-depth understandings of our customers and how consumers interact with products or brands or communities in the everyday marketplace have given rise to a need for more qualitative researchers, often with a background in psychology, to collect and analyze such data. Somewhat paradoxically, this two-parted development has, in a sense, brought the two ends of the spectrum closer to each other. Namely, the bigger the datasets grow, the easier it is for quantitatively oriented analysts to extract results that are statistically significant. However, not all such results may bear practical relevance in the marketplace, which calls for marketers then pairing these statistics with strong qualitative understandings of what is not only significant, but also relevant. On the other hand side, the more and more in-depth insights into consumers' minds have generated new calls for not only studying the individual consumers, but pairing the findings from these studies with statistical analysis of their generalizability. So whether what we observe is only related to the single individual being observed, or whether it can be generalized to broader groups of consumers also. So this development has, in a sense, simultaneously emphasized the need for marketers to develop both their qualitative and quantitative skills simultaneously. To reflect this paradox, I would like to end my presentation with the old wisdom attributable to sociologist William Bruce Cameron. Not everything that can be counted counts, and not everything that counts can be counted. Thank you.